It is September 30th, 2012. This is an interview with Sara Shapiro. Interviewer is Stephen Smith. We are in West Bloomfield, Michigan, USA.
And we're on.
My name is Stephen Smith. I am here with Sara Shapiro on the 30th of September 2012, and we're in Detroit, Michigan. Sara, thank you for agreeing to be interviewed for the USC Shoah Foundation's archive. I'd like to begin by asking you a question about your earliest memories and what you remember about your early childhood.
Oh, very, very good. My parents were very good people and hardworking, and we were loved by them, and everything was good. My parents were good people. They gave charity. They helped other people, and everything was good.
Can you tell me your name at birth?
Sara Shapiro. Sara Guralnik. I'm sorry.
And could you spell Guralnik for me?
G-U-G-U-L-I-N. Guralnik.
G-U-R.
Is it G-U-R or?
A-L-N-I-K.
Yeah. I'm sorry, I'm a little nervous.
It's okay.
Please.
Can you tell me your date of birth?
Yes. 5/10/30.
And so let me ask you about your parents. Tell me about your parents. What was your father's name?
Avrum Guralnik.
And your mother's name?
Tzivia Guralnik.
And do you have any early memories of your father? Do you remember him?
Yes, I do. Of course I do.
Can you describe him to me and your memories of him?
He was a very kind, loving father. Special, he loved me. I was the only girl. I had three brothers, one older, two younger, and I was named after his mother. So I was the first one that I was the first child named after his mother.
And what did your father do for a living? Do you remember?
Yes, I do. He owned land. He had means. He was a hardworking man. And my mother inherited a lot of money from when they killed her father and two brothers. And we had a lot of money, gold coins, and when Hitler came, he showed it to, we didn't know, my older brother and I, we didn't know that what we have. We had big pots, gold coins, and he opened up and he says, this is gold coins, money, because before we didn't know that we have it. It was a secret because we didn't pay tax at that time and there was no checks. So it was hidden someplace. And then when Hitler came, everything was open for us. My brother was older than I was, so he knew, but I did not.
Would you like to tell me the names of your brothers, your three brothers?
Yes, Meshe, Shunye, and Yene. Yoine or Yene, it's in Yiddish.
And Moshe was older than you. How many years older was he?
I would say around 3-4, I believe. So I at that time, we didn't think about age or birthdays or... We just wanted to survive.
And your two younger brothers, were they much younger?
One was 5 and one was like 3, almost 3.
So tell me a little bit more about your parents. Tell me about your mother and your memories of her.
Oh, she made arrangements with the Ukraine people to have us, keep us and hide us so when we'll survive.
But your very earliest memories of her, tell me about her in the home.
Oh, in the home, she was a good mother, loving mother, and that's all I can tell you. Like a mother, like I'm the mother.
And do you remember her cooking or?
Oh, yes, sir. Yes, she cooked, she baked. Yes, definitely. We didn't run to the restaurants. There was no restaurants.
And did you have a traditional Jewish home?
Yes. Every holiday was observed and everything was supposed to be.
And just tell me about the rhythm of that. As a child, when you were growing up, what are your memories of your family's traditions and home life?
Yeah, every Friday, Passover, we had Seder, and we were praying and everything else. And my mother was conscious about school, that school was important. We had tutors for my brother. We had Hebrew tutors coming to the house and teaching. And like every Jewish mother.
And did you go to the synagogue with her?
Yes, we did. Every holiday, Rosh Hashanah, Yom Kippur. And every Friday, every holiday we observed.
So you were an Orthodox Jewish family?
Yes.
And was that typical of the people living in your town?
Yes, we all the, I don't know who wasn't religious or Orthodox. We observed Saturday, Sabbath. We did what it's supposed to be done.
And what was the name of the town where you were born?
Koretz.
Was that a large place or a small place?
Small. I wouldn't say a large. But there was a very nice Jewish, what they call, Jewish people. And every Saturday we were going to shul, visiting family, and like it's supposed to be done.
What language did you speak at home, Sarah?
Yiddish.
And was that your only language?
No. My parents spoke Hebrew in between them, so we don't understand. And in school, I spoke Ukrainian and Polish.
So did you go to a regular public school? A Ukrainian public school?
Yes, I did.
And was that a mixed school with Ukrainian children and Jewish children?
Correct.
And what was your relationship like with the local Ukrainian children? Did you have much interaction with them?
Well, they didn't like the Jews, but that's about all.
And did you have Ukrainian friends? Do you remember friends that were not Jewish?
Not many.
And in terms of your circle of friends as a child, did you have Jewish friends that you spent time with?
Yes, I had Jewish friends, and I had cousins. So.
And do you remember their names, any of them, your cousins?
My cousins, yes, I do. One had 3 sons. Was Moshe, Motel, and Nuchem, their names.
And were they close to you in age, the boys?
No, older. My mother was the youngest, And the other one, the one that I just told you, was the oldest.
So your cousins were significantly older than you?
Oh, yes.
And do you remember that if your mother had siblings, how many siblings did she have?
Three. No, we were four. My brother, three brothers, and I is four.
And your mother had brothers and sisters. Do you remember how many uncles and aunties you had?
Yeah, she had, there were three sisters and two brothers.
And they all lived in Koretz or in the neighborhood nearby?
In Koretz, yeah.
And on your father's side, did your father have brothers and sisters?
Yes, he did. He had, there were seven. There were seven children.
So there was a large family then to get all together when you were... Did you have times when you all came together that you remember as a child?
Yeah, we were friendly. We played together. We did homework together. We, like a family should do.
And both your mother and your father, did their families live in Koretz, the whole extended family?
Yes.
When you got together as a family, what sort of memories do you have of the Goralnik? And what was your mother's maiden name?
Liebman.
And the Liebman families. What are your memories of of everyone being being together? Do you have strong memories of that?
Yeah, they were friendly. They were helping each other. And that's all I know.
So let me ask you a little bit about school life. You went to a Ukrainian school.
Yes.
What was the routine like there? Because you were in an elementary school, I guess.
Yes.
What was the routine like in school? What did you learn? What sort of classes did you go to? What kind of things did you learn?
We had math and Ukrainian, Polish, and that's about all.
And the classes were taught in which language?
In Ukraine. And not as much Polish, but Ukraine, because we lived on the border with Russia till 1939. In 1939, the Russian came. In 1941, Hitler came.
And so your Ukrainian language skills, were you fluent in Ukraine?
I was. But after so many years, you don't use it, you lose it, they say.
And what other languages do you speak?
Ukraine, Polish, Russian, Yiddish, and a little bit Hebrew, little bit. I know words, but I can't make a sentence.
So let me talk a little bit about your father's business. What did your father do for a living?
I told you we owned land, pieces all over, and he sugar beets. We seed it, and we harvest. Is that correct? And we send it to the factory, and the factory made sugar from the beets. Okay, and then he was a businessman, and we had a windmill, we had a lot of, he was lending money to people, and you go to the bank, and you pay interest, so that's he was in a lot of people, in a lot of, how do you say it?
A lot of different businesses.
Right. Thank you.
He must have been a very energetic man,
well,
sounds.
He tried. He had a wife with four kids, and he always worked.
Do you remember going to the windmill with him or to the...
Yeah, I did go to the windmill. Because it was not too far. But in the sugar factory, they don't let you in. So I didn't go.
Now, you mentioned earlier that your father came into some inheritance because somebody was killed.
Yes.
Could you tell me what happened?
My mother's father lent money. Is it lent? No.
Lent money, yeah.
Lent money, did I say it right?
You did.
And this man had no money to give to pay you back. So he decided he'll kill you. And that's what he did. He had two sons. They were in their 20s. And they were going to a bazaar. And when he was going home, he was waiting for... They were driving horse and buggy. Driving. They were in a horse and buggy. And he stopped and he killed the two boys and the grandfather. So he doesn't have to pay the money back. And that's what happened.
Do you know when that was, Sara?
That was before Hitler came, before the war started. I can't remember. I was a child that time. I'm not gonna lie because I don't know.
But do you remember that occasion? You remember that it happened?
No, after it. I don't remember. I wasn't even born that time. So I don't know. But the grandma and my mother talked about it.
Yeah. So I'd like to talk a little bit then about what happened when the war began. 1939, you already described that the Soviets came.
Yeah, 1939, the Russian came, yes.
Do you have any memory of that taking place when they arrived?
No, they arrived and they were going towards Hitler. And that's all I know. And in 1941, Hitler came.
So did things change at all for you when the Russians were there? Was there any change to your life at all at that time?
No. No, not at all. Same thing was going on.
So, and did you have any memories of them, the soldiers being there, or they weren't present in your life at all?
No.
And the routines that you'd been going through up until that point continued as normal?
Right.
Was there any change to your father's business, do you know? Did they impose themselves?
We didn't like it because when the Russian came and you are rich and this man is poor, they don't like that. They take away your money and it's like a kolkhoz, you know, it's a collective. And it was different than before you worked, you made money, it was yours. If you had money or you didn't have money, whatever you had, it was different. And that, when the Russian came, they said, no, you have to take your money and share with your neighbor. And we, of course, didn't like it. It was, for some people was it good, for some people was bad. But what are you going to do? Go fight the Russian? You're not going to fight them.
So do you remember your father having to change his whole style of business? Or do you remember anything?
No. He kept going.
So from 1939 to 1941, things remained much of an even keel for you.
Yeah.
Did you continue to go to school and do all of the same routines?
Yeah.
So in 1941, when the Nazis arrived, that would have been, I guess, June 1941?
I assume.
And at that time, you would have been 11 years old.
Yes.
So what do you remember about that occurrence, the Nazis arriving in Koretz?
What did you say?
What do you remember about the Nazis?
About the Nazis?
Arriving, yeah, and the change that occurred then.
At that time, was the same. They were going towards Siberia, Leningrad, Moscow. They were going that way.
So in the first period, when after the Nazis had taken the territory, you don't remember any change to
not that I remember.
So when did things begin to change for you?
Well, when they came and they were digging graves and killing the people.
And do you remember when that was?
42, I believe. I can't. After so many years, it's very hard for me to remember.
So what do you remember? Do you remember emotions at all, or reactions to what was occurring as a child? When you heard that they were killing the Jews?
Yes.
What do you remember how you felt and what your thoughts?
Pretty bad. Pretty bad. And then they killed, I think, how many people? At that time, 20-something, they said. And whoever survived, they took us to the ghetto.
So how did your parents at that time, do you remember their reactions and what they said to you as children, or how they...
Very bad. Very bad.
And in what way? How did they convey or talk to you about it?
Well, my mother was very religious. She used to fast twice a week. Pray, sit home in the ghetto, and twice a week she fasted and she prayed, and she said that maybe we will survive. That she meant my brother and I. That what she would be thankful to God if we would survive.
So. There was killing that took place in Koretz in 1942.
Yes.
How is it that your family were not killed at that time? Do you know what happened?
The first action, I told you, they were coming to the house and taking you and to the graves and kill you. And if you survived, they take you to the ghetto.
And when you say they came to the house, who was it that came?
The SS with big dogs, German dogs. And that's what they did.
Were you still living in your original family home at that time?
Right.
So can you describe that day for me, what you remember of that day?
Yeah, they came and they knocked the door open with their food, and they grabbed you, and then we didn't know what's going on. So my dad said, let's hide, and we had a headache. And then he said, let's walk, climb to the attic. And we did, and he took the ladder and so nobody can come up.
Yeah.
Thank you. And we were quiet for about 2-3 hours, I suppose, and it stopped. The people, the German, stopped coming and grabbing you to the, and then we whoever survived went to the ghetto.
And do you remember who was in the attic that day with you?
My mother, my father, my three brothers.
And do you remember what you felt like when you were sitting up
pretty
there?
Pretty bad. We didn't know what happened. And then we walked out and we asked what happened, and other people told us. They were taking all the Jews, capturing and killing them. And they killed a lot of people at that time. And if you, they were going by the hours. If they started, they had a plan what to do. And if you survived after that, they take you to the ghetto.
And on that first action, do you remember whether other members of your family were killed that time?
Yes, yes.
Can you tell me who? Or
my my dad had, there were seven children, and none were survived. They killed them.
And did your were your grandparents still alive at that time?
Grandmother, that's all. One grandmother.
And she survived the action or not?
No, she didn't. She did. Wait a minute, I can't remember exactly.
So most of your parents' own siblings on your father's side were all murdered, and on your mother's side, do you know what happened? Did they survive that day? Like your uncles and aunties on your mother's side?
On my father's side, they're all killed. On my mother's side, they survived. Some, not all.
And do you remember how long it was before they formed the ghetto? Was that instantaneous, or did it take a little time to organize?
I can tell you, I don't know, because I was not interested. I was a child. I didn't ask questions.
So when they did form the ghetto, did you then move house, or was your house within the ghetto area?
In the ghetto in the area.
So you were able to stay in the house?
No. And another story, when we came to the ghetto, we had a doctor that he was in the ghetto. And then we had another building with Russian soldiers. They were captured. And this doctor came every day, and he was trying to heal them, and not if they were wounded. He how did you call this?
The bandages?
Yes. Mm-hmm. And after 5-6 months, he says, are you Jewish, to the doctor? And he says, yes. He says, go home and tell your brothers and sisters that they're digging graves, and the SS is around. And one of these days, it's going to be another action. And he did. He went, and there was no telephone to call you house to house. And he says, people run because they're digging graves. And in about 2-3 days, it's going to be another pogrom.
So who was providing that information to the doctor?
A Russian soldier, that he was coming, and he was, if you were wounded, he was taking care of you.
So is it your understanding that the Russian soldiers were helping to dig the graves?
Yeah.
They had been given that work?
Yeah. Yeah, they were working on the outside, and they were fixing the roads.
Were there many of these soldiers? Did you see them?
Yeah, they were next to to the ghetto. It was maybe, I don't know, 100 or less. I didn't count them, and I can't say a lie how many, approximately.
So when you moved into the ghetto, Sara, what are your memories of living in the ghetto?
Pretty bad. Excuse me, pretty bad.
Where did you live? Do you remember?
No, I don't.
Do you remember what the conditions were like?
Bad. Bad. We had one room, and then one young man survived, and he had nowhere to be, so they put him in our room.
So that was you and your parents and your brothers were living in one room with one additional person that had been placed with you.
A stranger.
And do you have any recollections of what food provision there was? Was there food?
Food, yeah. A piece of bread for one person and soup. That's all.
And was there work in the ghetto? Was there work?
Yes, mm-hmm. Yes. We had to go work. We had to go on the field to work to cut tobacco because they were like beets. The tobacco also was seeded and growing, and you had to cut it. And every person who survived had to go to work. And they had to clean the streets and clean toilets and a lot of other stuff.
And so you were doing some of this work, were you? Do you remember which work you did?
Cleaning streets, toilets. I remember.
And your older brother was also working?
Yes.
Do you remember what he was doing?
Cleaning the streets, cleaning whatever. He didn't sit in the office to work, that's for sure.
And your parents, do you remember what they were doing?
I had two siblings, so my mother couldn't leave them. And I told her, Mom, you take care of the kids and I'll go to work.
Oh, so were you working in your mother's place?
Right.
And did you make that decision yourself?
Yes.
And how did you come, as you did that, what did that make you feel? Did you feel that you were contributing to the family life, or what was your feeling at that time?
I'm not sure. What was the feeling? I can't tell you. I was a child. I was around 11 years old at that time, and I did what I had to do.
And do you remember what your father was doing at that time?
Mostly working also. They took him on the fields, and he had to work.
Do you remember much about the atmosphere among the Jewish people at that time in the ghetto, following the action that had taken place? What was the atmosphere like among people?
Bad. Bad. A lot of people lost their family, and they were upset, and they got emotional, and they had to go to doctors, and not good. That's what I remember.
Do you remember anything about how the ghetto was organized on a day-to-day basis? Did you see the Germans there? Were they around? Or was it...
This ghetto, you can go out and come in, and you had to wear a star in the back and in the front, a Jewish star, that if they catch you, and you don't have it, they beat you.
But you were able to go out of the ghetto.
Right.
Was there a fence, or was it just demarcated?
They couldn't do nothing. The way the building was, they couldn't do nothing. They left alone.
So there was an area of the town that was allocated as the ghetto, and you moved into that area, and then you had to wear the yellow star.
Yes.
The first time that you wore that, do you remember having to wear it when you put the yellow star on? Do you remember that?
No, I don't remember. I just don't remember.
But you know that you did have to wear it.
Right.
In the ghetto itself, was there a sense, once the doctor came back and told the news, how did you find out about the news that they were digging the mass graves?
this doctor came to the ghetto and told, and he says, you go tell the people to, if they can run away, they should. And when they came and they told my mother, and she said, well, I made arrangements with this Ukraine people, and I gave them money and gold and whatever they wanted. And if you and the your brother will run away, and she said she's going to take care of you kids. And I said, no, if they're going to kill you, let them kill me. I'm not going. And I started to cry. And I says, I'm not going without you. And she says, yes, you are. And if she said something, I didn't listen. But when the father said, that meant business. He never hit me. He looked at me and he says, you are going. Your mother wants you to go. And she started to pack a few clothes for me. And I says, I'm not taking nothing. And it started to get dark, and my brother and I ran away from the ghetto, and we had to go 8-9 kilometers, and we had to go through
a
stream, and I almost fell and drowned, and he pulled me out. He saved me because he was a boy, he was older, and he knew that I'm younger, and he caught me and saved me. And we went through that stream, and we sat for a couple hours till it got very dark, and we walked to this lady, and we came in, and we knocked in the door, in the window, and she was still not sleeping, and she saw us, and she says, oh my God, what are you doing here? So we told her we just came because we were in the neighborhood. And she says, then go in the barn and stay there. And we did.
So your mother had already given this lady some money to do this, so she was expecting you, presumably.
Money, and I don't know. She made the arrangements. She expected. But she backed out. She wasn't too happy that we came.
When you left the ghetto, you say it was getting dark. Were you then traveling during the night to get to her place?
Yes, we walked. We walked. It's maybe 8 kilometers.
And had you ever, what was the name of the place you went to, where the lady's house was?
Bogdanovka.
Had you ever been there before?
Yes.
Did your family have friends there or?
No, just a friend. I mean, yeah, friends. Yeah. And she told my mother that if we need help, we should turn to her.
So when you arrived and you went into the barn,
yeah.
Was there any provision for you there? Were you able to? How long were you staying there for?
Couple weeks, 2 weeks, I think. That's it.
Do you remember when this was? What time of year it was?
Yeah, in the fall.
So where you don't know the date at all? Do you know the approximate date of that?
No, I don't. I had no calendar, and we didn't care the date. We wanted to survive. It didn't matter what date. There was no calendars, nothing.
I think you mentioned to me about the Jewish holidays around that time. Do you remember which holiday it was close to?
Yeah, I think it was Yom Kippur and Rosh Hashanah, something like that. I think it was in the fall.
In the ghetto, around that time of the High Holidays in 1942, did your family still celebrate the holidays?
No celebration. No.
So had religious life stopped as well? Your father was not able to go to pray. The men were not able to come together.
No, forget it.
So everything came to a halt.
Yes.
So when you went to this barn, so you're saying maybe between Rosh Hashanah and Yom Kippur?
Maybe in September or October. I'm not too sure, but I know it was already fall.
Did she allow you to stay there for long?
No, she said go over there and stay there. And in the morning she would come and bring us a glass of milk and a piece of bread. And at night, I remember that she would cook potatoes in sour milk. So that was our supper.
And did you leave the barn at all?
No.
You stayed in the barn?
We stayed in the barn. We were hiding it. If somebody would see us, that's it.
Were you still wearing your yellow star, or had you removed that?
Removed.
And so you stayed in the barn. Was there a hiding place in the barn, or were you just living?
There was hay and straw, and there was a, I don't know what to call, that we were laying down there.
And she would come and she would feed you. Did you see anybody except her? Was she the only person you saw?
Yeah.
Did she have a family, or do you remember?
No, she had no children. A husband.
And he was also aware that you were there?
Yeah.
So after the 2 weeks or so that you were there, what changed and why did things change?
Nothing changed. She came in and she says that she has bad news because they're already killing all the Jews in Koretz. So that's the end of it.
And so she wanted you to move at that point?
Yeah.
So when you heard that the Jews of Koretz were being killed, obviously that meant that your family were still there. Do you remember your feelings at that time and your reactions?
Bad. We were sitting and crying and said that's the end of it. We knew that the parents cannot go nowhere with the kids. There is nowhere, no place to run, no place to go. And she told this lady that she's praying and hoping that the two of us survive.
Your mother told this to the lady? Yeah. So you then, what happened about at that time then? She asked you to leave, or did you decide?
Yes, every day, every morning. And I said to my brother, that's it. It's either dead or life. I'm leaving. And I picked myself up, and I kissed him goodbye, and I walked out from the barn. And one side is Russia, second side is Ukraine. And what do you do? Where do you go? What do you say? And I picked myself up and I says, I'm going that way, where the farmers, they might need help. And I walked and walked and walked, and all of a sudden I saw two young men were cutting the grass. And I said, I'm going to go there. And I walked over, and I said, hello. And they said, hello. And I says, I'm so-and-so, and I'm looking for work. And maybe you know. And he says, aren't you Jewish? I said, no, I'm not. And my name is Manya Romanchuk, and blah, blah, blah. And he says, well, if you go in the house and wait an hour or two, if I finish my work, maybe my neighbor will hire you. I says, good. Didn't eat nothing, hungry. I asked him for a glass of water. He gave me a glass of water. And then he says, what's your name? And he wrote it down, and he says, and drew a little map, and he says, maybe he'll hire you. And I did. And I walked the whole day from Bogdanovka to Tudorov. And I knocked in the window, and they said, who are you? And I said, hello. And I gave him the piece of paper. Uh-huh. So it's our neighbor. And they asked me who I am, my name, and I did. And they say, well, aren't you Jewish? I said, no. And she says to me, are you hungry? I said, yes. She gave me a piece of bread and a piece of pork. She tested me. She wanted to know if I eat it, and I did. And after I ate, I crossed myself. And she says, are you tired? I said, yes. So she took a mattress from straw in the other room, and she gave me a pillow and a blanket. And she said, you can sleep here. And she says, I'll try you, what you can do. I said, good. Whatever she said, I agreed. Then she says, what do you want to get paid? And I said, a piece of bread. So she liked it because she had a real big, strong maid, and she made trouble between her husband and her, and the husband beat her up, and it's a long story.
The husband beat the maid up?
No, the wife. The wife, and she ran away to the neighbor. 2 days later, she came back because she had children and whatever. And she threw out the maid, so she needed a maid. And I was too young for her. But I said, only a piece of bread. So she figured, what can she lose?
How did you come up with the name Manya Romanchuk?
Uh-huh. Manya Romanchuk was in school with me, sitting next to me. And we were school kids, friendly, and I took her name. And then I said, my mother died, and she hates me. So my mother died, and my dad remarried, and I have a stepmother, and the stepmother hates me. That was my lullaby.
And so you gave the impression that you'd run away from home?
Correct.
Now, Tudorov, I believe you told me, is now the town of Fedorenko, I think.
I don't know.
It changed names, I believe. So at the time it was called Tudorov.
Tudorov. This is 65 years.
And could you describe what you did in the home? What were your duties?
Okay. Everything you mentioned, and I did everything. They had horses, they had cows, they had pigs, they had chickens, they had, you name it, and I did it.
And was it a little farm or a little?
Not a little, a big farm.
So you worked in the house and you also worked on the farm then?
Anything, I did everything.
Did you work with the children as well?
Right.
What sort of ages were the children?
6 and 3, I believe. 2 boys.
And was she warm and welcoming? Or you said that she tried to trick you. Do you feel that she was suspicious of you still?
Yes, yes.
How did she display that? What happened?
Well, she was not bad and not good. She, whatever she told me, I did. I worked anything you want me to do, I did. at that age.
If she had found out that you were Jewish, what do you think would have happened?
She would tell me out. And then the husband, he asked me if I go back to the place where I was born and bring him a paper from the mayor, like, and I can come back and live there. I says, good, sure. I didn't say I'm not going. He was testing me, and I walked out for about a couple blocks or whatever. He says, Manya, come back. I'm going to take care of it. And Manya came back. And they were trying to catch me. They were asking me many, many times. Maybe my father was Jewish. Maybe my mother was Jewish. Who was it, Mickey? Oh.
So they would continue to test you to try and find out if you would give your identity.
Right.
Because they didn't trust you.
Right.
And did they ever get close to finding that out, or were you able to conceal your identity successfully? You were able to hide your real identity successfully?
Not much. I didn't know from today till tomorrow if I'll be alive.
So how did that feel on a day-to-day basis? When you went to sleep at night, did you feel secure or did you feel frightened?
Yes and no. More frightened.
And did they give you somewhere a room to stay in, or did you stay in one of the... Where did you sleep?
On a mattress from straw. And the rooms was like you walk in small rooms. You walk in, and then a kitchen, a bedroom, and a guest room. It was like this and like this, broken up. I can't explain.
And so you had a routine each day working with this family. Did you ever come across anybody else that was Jewish that was also in hiding, or anybody?
No, there was his brother. He had a brother, and he, all of a sudden, a Jewish young lady came in, and she had gold pieces, a bag, and she wanted to pay him the money. And he took the money and told her leave, and she left. She left, and they killed her.
They raped her?
Yes.
Who did that?
Ukraine. Yes.
Members of that family? Were they members of that family?
Anybody. And she ran away. She came to my house, and she said, Manya, I'm so-and-so, and can you help me? Can you give me help? And I would appreciate if you help me. And I says, I cannot. They asked her if she knows Manya, and she definitely didn't know me. If she would say she knows me, then I'm gone. But she said she didn't know me.
So how did you find out that she had been raped?
They talked about it, and I heard. They talked. What they did with Rachel, her name was Rachel, she was gorgeous in the 20s. She had blonde hair, blue eyes, and a real, real pretty girl. That's what they did.
Can you remember what they said, what they described? Can you remember what they said about the assault and how they raped her?
Yeah, they were laughing and told each other what they did with that Rachel.
And did they, had they, do detained her and passed her around, or what happened? Do you remember?
No. I was a child that I didn't even know what they were talking about, but I put two and two together, and they killed her.
So it was the Ukrainians that were actually, that you were staying with, and their neighbors that had, she'd gone to them for help.
Yeah.
She had then given them money.
Right. They took away the money. That's what they wanted. And they told her to leave.
And then she was raped and killed by the same neighborhood?
I don't know. Who killed her? I don't know. I didn't ask. I heard that what they were talking. And there were other people too. They were hiding Jewish people. They were hiding in the barns, and they caught them and they killed them, and they were talking all kind of things.
So you heard your Ukrainian family talking about how the Jews were discovered,
yeah,
by the Ukrainians.
Yes.
And then killed by the Ukrainians.
Right.
In your conversation with Manya, was that just once? With Rachel, when she came to you to
speak? She came and she hugged me and she said, Manya, help me. And then she said, I'm hungry. Do you have a piece of bread for me? So I said, I'm not sure. And I went to my the people that hired me, and I said, Chacha Ala, there is a lady here, and she asked me for a piece of bread. Can I give it to her? And she says, well, take a look if there is on the table any. Give it to her. And I don't remember. I think I gave her a piece of bread, and she didn't want to leave. She wanted to stay. And I just walked away.
And how did you feel when you heard what had happened to her?
Bad. Real, real bad.
Were there any other people that you came into connection with while you were there that were either in hiding or other?
Well, there were Banderovci and Bulbovci, and they were coming at night and taking away the husbands, and then taking your food from your house, and all kind of things. And one day they came and they knocked on the door, and the husband said, "Don't open the door. Nobody can get not to open the door in at night, because he heard that they came and they raped somebody, and that was like Banderovci. It was a group. They were fighting the Russian."
So like partisans?
Partisans,
and they were Ukrainian partisans, or?
Any nationality. And they would take away your clothes, the food, whatever they needed, they took it and left.
And you heard also that they had been raping women part of that?
Yeah.
And they were looting?
Looting, yeah.
And were they responsible for finding the Jews, and you know who was doing that? Were they part of that?
No. They were just hungry and they were partisan. No.
So they would come out of the forests or wherever they were in hiding, and they would loot and then return?
Correct.
And so you were aware of that the Nazis were there, and if you were caught, you would be handed to the Nazis. And there was also this...
They were, I guess, partisan. And who knows? I'm not sure.
Right. Now, you mentioned that the lady's name was Chacha Ala.
Chacha is in Allah was her name, and Chocha is aunt, so sort of, yeah.
Do you know what her family name was?
No.
And do you remember do you remember the man's name? Do you remember her husband's name?
Yeah, Petro Romanchuk. Petro Romanchuk, and mine was Dohopoluk. Romanchuk, Petro Dohopoluk. Yeah.
So his name was
Dohopoluk.
Dohopoluk.
Yeah, and mine was Romanchuk.
Right. And did they, you mentioned that he had a brother.
Yes.
And it was the brother that stole the money from Rachel.
He didn't steal, he took it. He took the money and that's it.
Did he live in the neighborhood? Was he?
Two 5 minutes from us.
So how did Rachel then come to your house? Do you remember? Did they bring her around to try and disclose your identity?
It was like 10 minutes to walk.
And so she just found her way to the house on her own?
I don't know how, don't ask me. She came. She was hungry. She wanted a piece of bread.
While you were in the home, did you hear any other news about what had been happening to the Jews?
Yes.
What did you hear?
At that time, not much, because they killed everybody, but they said there were some that they captured, and that's all. And I pretend I don't hear, I don't see, I don't hear, and that saved me. Don't open your mouth, and that's what I did. I did, and I pretend I'm dumb, I don't know nothing. If they asked me, I answered if I knew. If I didn't, I said, no, I'm sorry, and that was it.
So how did you know instinctively to do that?
God knows. I don't know. I really don't know.
So when you left the original barn, you left Moshe behind in the barn. Do you know what happened after that with him?
Yeah, he was wandering from one place to the other, and they caught him, and they turned him into the police, Ukraine police, and that's it.
So local Ukrainian people in the neighborhood handed him to the Ukrainian
police? Yes, yes.
And how do you know that?
Well, I came back when we were liberated from the Russian, and I didn't say who I am. I just told them I want to go see my stepmother. And they say, well, if you want to, you can. And I did. And I stayed 3-4 days and came back. And I told them that she's okay, she's fine, and that's it. And they were pleased. And then I went, after a month or two, I said, I have to go back. I have to see my stepmother. And they say, well, if you feel like going, go. And I did. And I walked to the main road, and I saw I'm not going to make it from Tudorov to Koretz, and it was already noon. I'll never make it. And all of a sudden, I saw a jeep with three men, Russian, coming towards Koretz, and they had a flat tire. And I ran over, and I said, could you give me a ride? And they said, no, we can't, because we're not allowed to take civilian. And I said, please, I have a mother, and she's dying, and I want to see her. And I start to cry. And he says, well, I have to fix my tire. If you want to wait, I'll put you on the jeep. And I did. And that's before Koretz, he let me off.
Do you remember when that was?
in the fall. It was before Passover, so that would be...
in the early part of 1944, I guess.
Right, something like that, 44, 45.
So you had given yourself leave to go and see your stepmother, and you found the Russians.
Three of them, they were in driving a jeep.
So was this the beginning of the liberation by the Russians of that area?
Yeah, yes. I think so. I can't remember exactly. I'm getting already cuckoo.
And tell me, when you were in hiding, when the husband had asked you to go and find your paper, and you walked and then he called you back, did he ever follow up on that and try and find... He just left it?
Left it. No more questions.
So at that point then, you didn't have any formal identity, only what you were telling them.
Right. And he wanted to have on black and white, but he told me, I'll take care.
When you went to see the woman and you told them that you were going to see your stepmother, you went to go and try and find Moshe. That was what your purpose was.
Yeah.
Do you know how long after you'd been in the house that was? Was it a short while or was it quite a while later?
A what? Oh.
How long after you'd been hired, how long was that before you went back to the barn, to the house, to see the woman that...
I can't remember.
And once she told you that he'd been handed over, did you assume at that point that he'd been killed? Or did she know that he'd been killed?
What?
At the point at which she told you that he'd been handed to the Ukrainian police,
yeah.
Did you know that he'd been killed, or did you...
Of course. Once you handle to the police, you're not going to be alive. Not going to be alive, that's for sure.
And so how did you react to that news when she told you?
Pretty bad. Pretty bad. I didn't stop crying. Pretty bad.
And then how long did you stay there before you went back? Did you spend some time with her?
Maybe a month or two, a couple months.
And then you went back to the original house where you'd been hired? And they took you back in again?
Yeah. And then I went back, and they didn't know where I was. And somebody saw me in Koretz, and they came to look for me. And they said, come back to us. And I said, no way. They didn't ask me if I have a piece of bread to eat or anything, nothing. They were mad. And then the husband said to me, you're lucky. In Ukraine, you're lucky. And they asked me to come back to live with them. And I said, no.
So by this time you were back in Koretz. The Russians had liberated Koretz.
Right.
What did you find when you got to Koretz? What was there?
Nothing. Misery. Nothing. What can I find? It was pretty, pretty bad.
And were there other survivors that were there?
Yes. There were people, not many. You can count them on the fingers. Not many. They survived in the partisan. Some were in Russia, some in the graves, not graves, the bunkers, all kind of.
And did you find anybody that you knew? Was there any family members that survived?
No.
And were there any friends or family friends that you knew at all?
One that I knew.
And so you were there from when the Russians liberated it in early 44. How long did you stay in Koretz for?
For maybe a year, I think so.
Do you remember where you lived?
I remember where I lived.
Where did you live?
In a very bad place. The room was not heated, no water, running water, nothing. It's pretty bad. It's indescribable.
At this time, I guess you would have been 14 years old?
I think, yes. 14, 15.
And you were living on your own. How did you get food, for example?
Pretty bad. I went and I to a Russian place that they, if you have nobody, you're like me, they gave you a piece of rationing. Is it rationing?
Yeah.
Yeah. And once a day you can have a soup and a piece of bread.
And when you were there, did you do any work or did you have a routine? What was your life like?
There was no routine. No routine. You on your own.
And were you looking for family at that time? Were you trying to find out what had happened?
Yeah. I was looking, but I didn't find any.
Mm. And in addition to that, did you make new friends when you were in Korets at that time?
Yeah. Yeah, I did.
Can you tell me who?
I don't know. They died. They died already. I can't remember their name.
And so how did you come to then leave Korets? Because you left at some point after that, did you?
Yeah. What? Well, there was a... they let it out papers, and they said if you are born, if you are a survivor, you can leave, you're welcome to leave Ukraine. And I went and I registered that I want to go. And I registered, and then after, you know, a certain time, I went, I left.
And did you leave on your own at that point? Or did you go with other survivors?
Other survivors.
Do you remember how many of you left?
One. I had to have a older person and put on the certificate. Mm-hmm. And he put me on the certificate. And that's the way I could leave Russia.
So he was like a guardian to
you? A guardian.
Do you remember his name?
Bergel. He died. He went to Israel. It's a long time.
So he took you as a guardian. And where did you go to from Korets?
From Korets, we went to Waldenburg. Waldenburg, yeah, I think so.
And that was a displaced persons camp, was it?
No, it was a kibbutz.
And do you know where it was?
Waldenburg. No, I don't.
No. The kibbutz was in the town, or was it near the town?
In the town.
And this is, do you know who established the kibbutz?
No.
And presumably many of the people in the kibbutz were also survivors?
Some of them, yes. From other countries, from other place.
And how long were you on the kibbutz for?
A couple months.
And then how? What was the life like on the kibbutz? How did it get there in the first place? Do you know how it was established?
No. They told us to go there. They told me to go there, and because I was orphan, and they gave you food, but you had to clean and do some work in the kitchen, and I did.
And did you meet other people there? Did you make friends there at all?
Yes. What time is it?
I don't know, actually.
It's 10:45.
I think I'm tired.
Yeah, I'm sure you are.
I'm tired. How much longer?
I can ask you a few questions about how you then came to America. If you've got a few, would you like a few more minutes to do that?
Yeah.
Are you okay to keep going, or would you like a little break?
A little break.
Let's have a break.
Yeah, I'll take a little water maybe.
Okay, do you want to...
I'll go and get it in the kitchen.
Okay.
I'm trying.
That's good. Thank you. So after the kibbutz, you then moved on again, did you, Sarah? After the kibbutz,
yes,
you moved on again. Where did you go to from there?
Again.
You moved on to another place after the kibbutz.
No, I met my husband. I met him in Koretz, and he came and he found his younger sister. They were four children, and they killed. They killed the mother, the father, and the brother, and the younger sister ran away to the partisan, and she survived. And he found out that she's alive, so he came to Koretz, and he found her, and then he took her, and they went to Poland. And in Poland, he knew me in Koretz. He knew who I was. And he asked me to marry him. And I says, I'm not getting married. I'm too young. But I guess God wanted us. And he found me in Waldbruch. And we got married in the kibbutz.
So he came to find you in...
In
you said Waldbruch or
Waldbruch, yeah, Waldbruch.
And he came to find you, and then
he found me, and we got married in the kibbutz.
Tell me about your wedding.
Oh, we had 500 people. What do you think? We had four people. We called a rabbi, and we got married. And that's it. And we stayed in Waldbruch, and then we had to move to go to Wasseralfingen.
And what was at Wasseralfingen?
DP camp.
And so why did you choose to do that rather than staying in the kibbutz?
We didn't choose. The people from the kibbutz, they told you what to do. They told you.
And do you know how far that was to Wasseralfingen?
No, I don't. I never asked, and I was not interested.
And where is that near? What would be the biggest cities that would be close to?
München and Stuttgart.
And where did you live on the DP camp? What sort of housing did you have there?
I think I have a picture if you want.
Oh, we'll have a look in a minute, yes.
Yeah.
So there was you and your husband, Asa.
Right. And his sister. And then she, after 1 year, she decided she had a sister that got married before Hitler, before the war, and she lived in Israel. So she decided she wants to go to Israel, to the sister. And she did.
And what was her name?
Ita Shapiro.
So she moved to Israel in 1946 or something?
No, in 1948, I believe.
So you were on the kibbutz, and then you moved to Wasseralfingen in what year? Do you know what year?
I didn't move. They brought people from all over to
Wasseralfingen.
Wasseralfingen.
And do you know how many years that you were there for?
Well, Mickey was born 47, 48, 49. 49 we came to America.
And how did you manage to get to America? What was the way in which that occurred?
Asa had an uncle, and he sent papers. And that's Mickey and Asa and I. We came to America.
And where did you arrive to? Which port did you come into?
In New York, what they call...
Ellis Island?
Yeah, thank you. Yeah. And we came to America.
And tell me about the journey over. How did you travel over? Do you remember the ship and when you left?
Yeah, General Sturdest. Yeah, I remember the ship. I threw up. like a faucet. I was sick like a dog. And Mickey was on the boat, and somebody cut his thumb with closing the door. Mickey was not even 2 years old.
And when you arrived in America, where did you go from there, from Ellis Island?
To Detroit. And we went to Detroit, and we stayed about 6 months or 8 months with the uncle, and then Asa found a job, and we moved away.
So tell me about your life in America once you arrived here.
Yeah.
What sort of reception did you get from the local community or from?
Not much. A lot of people came and they went to the Jewish Federation and they got money, they got food, they got a house. Asa said, I'm not taking nothing, I'm going to work. And he worked on two jobs. And by working hard and being honest, people liked him.
And what did he work as? What was his job?
He worked as in a lumber yard. A friend of the uncle gave him the job, and two people opened up a lumber yard and put two men to work, and the two men still stole a lot of things, and the guy went broke. And Asa said, I'm going to take over. And it's a long story. It's a dirty story, because the man got sick and got a heart attack, and it's not a pleasant story. But Asa opened up the lumber yard that was going, went broke, and made it work by working hard.
Did you feel welcomed by the Jewish community here? Did you?
Yes, but we never went to beg for money or bother them. And they didn't sponsor us. The uncle did. So I'm sure we could have gone and ask, but Asa said, as long as I'm alive and I can work, I'm going to work.
And then your family began to grow a little more. How many more children did you have after
Stevie and Eddie?
And what years were they born?
I think Stevie, I think I gave you the 53, and Eddie, what? Can't remember. I have it written in the book. You must have it.
I have it in there. Yeah, we'll make a note of it.
I can't remember my own children born. I'm tired, I'll be honest with you.
Would you like to show me some photographs? I'd love to do that. Do
yeah.
Pause for a second.
Oh. Yeah,
go ahead.
This is Asa's sister, Ita. This is Asa. This is Mickey. And that's me.
And where were you when this photograph was taken?
In Wasserreifingen. That's me. That's Mickey.
And what year was that taken in?
48, I believe. I believe so.
Okay.
That's Asa. And that's Mickey.
Okay.
And that's Mickey in Gies. And that's in Wasserreifingen. Taken. Okay. Yeah.
Who is this?
Asa. And I don't know if it's Mickey or Stevie. I'm not sure. I can't see.
And there's a little guy there as well. So maybe that's Maybe Mickey and Stevie is.
I think so.
And where would that be taken?
Someplace in America, yeah.
Okay, and who's this?
Mickey, at the list from the Bar Mitzvah, the list.
Okay.
Stevie, and I don't know what year it was.
Can't it says 1962 on it.
Oh, yeah? I can't see.
Do you want to describe this for us?
Asa's plane. That's all I can tell you.
And who's in the picture with the plane?
And that's Mickey. Mickey.
Okay.
And who do we have here?
You should know. Asa and Sara.
Okay.
Mickey and his horse. This is Spencer, Eddie's son. Eddie is right here, my younger. And what else do I?
Who are all the people? Tell us who all the people are.
This is Stevie, my middle son. This is his wife.
This and what's her name?
Margie. And this is David, that's Stevie's son. This is, of course, me, Asa, Mickey, Karen, his wife. David is Stevie's older son. And this is Lisa. She's the baby, Lisa. Okay, you got it?
Got it.
I hope I did it right.
You did it perfect.
And, of course, that's me, Asa, Mickey, Karen, Michael, Lisa, and this is Spencer, me, Eddie, Stevie's wife, and David.
And then I'll just maybe ask a few questions of you. You know, just what it's been like to be here in Detroit as a family, and what makes you proud of her. We're very proud of you today. I'm sure everybody's very proud of you. We'll hear a little bit about that. So that's what we're going to do. It's going to be very simple. Rolling.
Getting happens.
He's happy.
No?
He's happy.
Okay. Oh, I thought he was. Okay.
Yeah.
No.
He's listening to us.
Drawing.
Okay, so we have to get like a little... will you get a napkin, honey?
Okay.
Yeah.
Okay.
Ready?
Okay.
Hang on, just relax.
Okay.
So, we're here with the Shapiro family. Sarah, would you like to introduce your family to us?
Yes. I'm Sara Shapiro, and my husband, Asa Shapiro. My son is Mickey Shapiro, Karen Shapiro, Eddie Shapiro,
Steve
Shapiro, Marty Shapiro, and we have Michael, David, and Lisa, and Spencer.
Grandchildren.
The grandchildren. And they're my dearest. And that's all I can tell you.
It's a very beautiful family. You must be very proud of your mom today. How does it feel to be here as a family?
Yeah.
Okay. Very nice to
and
be together.
And I forgot Ari Shapiro, he's a...
Ari Shapiro.
Ari Shapiro, he's the adapted one. I'm sorry.
He's the youngest.
Yeah, I'm sorry. I had a hard day today.
It's okay.
So tell me what it feels like to be here as a family, and particularly with your mom giving her testimony. You must be very proud of her.
Very lucky. Very proud.
Speak up, eh?
So very lucky and very proud.
You're so cute.
Mickey's the oldest, and then Mickey was born in Germany, right?
Yes.
In a displacement camp. And then they came to the United States in 1949.
Correct.
And then Stephen was born, what, 6 years later?
53.
53.
Yeah. And then Eddie was born?
56.
56.
So, Asa, I was hearing that you went to the kibbutz to find that beautiful girl.
The what?
To find the beautiful girl after the Holocaust. Uh-huh. And you got married.
Uh-huh.
And tell me about the beautiful girl that you married. What can you tell me about your beautiful wife?
About who?
About ma'am. About ma'am.
I had a shotgun, you know, and I said, you gotta meet this girl. That's the only one girl left.
And you got married. You got married. You got married together, and then you came to Detroit.
Yeah.
Are you very proud of your children?
Pardon?
Are you very proud of your children?
Hey.
You got a beautiful family. Beautiful.
Okay.
So tell me, you guys grew up in a home where both of your parents were Holocaust survivors. Were you aware of the experience? Did your parents talk to you about it?
No, not really. Yes and no. They didn't tell us the bad parts. They tried to shelter us from it. They didn't want us to have any anger or hatred towards anybody. They always told us everybody, there's good and bad in everybody. And just always look for the good, if you can.
I found something interesting. I've been married to Stephen now for 27 years. And basically, until we had children, our children, and we went as a family to the Holocaust Museum in Washington, that was probably the first time my mother-in-law could really tell us stories. And I think she wanted to teach her grandchildren, you know, and share with them. And it was like an opening for all of us, because we hadn't heard a lot of these stories. And she just opened up for about 2 hours with the kids.
And so how did the children respond to that?
The children, well, I think they were at first in a lot of shock, disbelief, and they had so much compassion and sympathy.
It was a new chapter in our history of our family.
Right.
And has it been important for you as a family to be able to talk about?
Extremely. Extremely.
In terms of the impact that your parents have had on your lives, especially the boys, what key sort of direction for life has your mom and dad given you, and what sort of example have they set for you? Maybe Mickey.
Well, they set an example. Listen, let's go back to the beginning. They had their lives were gone. My mother lost her whole life, but her youth, her whole youth. But and she survived, and she. But they both lost all their family, so they both lost everything. But she was young, so her youth was gone at 11 years old. So she grew up real fast, and not in a good way because her memories were so bad. So there's a burden that both of them took, and they didn't want to. I don't think they wanted to share it. I think they wanted to keep it to themselves. As I think survivors do, most, they try to keep it to themselves, that I found. It takes a lot to get them talking. But when they do, you learn stories. And I think having them as parents, we were very fortunate because their experiences taught us that life isn't so easy. You don't take anything for granted. And if you want something, you better work because it's not going to come without work and hard work.
And what was it like to work? I think Steve and Eddie, you both worked with your father. What was it like to work together?
Oh, lots of fun.
lots of fun.
It's the best. We had a wonderful example. Work hard. And if you work hard and you do and you have a good honor and a good name, that you'll go places in life. We're very proud of the good name we have in the community. 60 years of being in business. Not too many companies like ours survived. And I believe that God blessed us to be able to withstand what has been happening in the last 4 or 5 years, and we're very lucky.
And Karen, what's it been like for you to join this family?
Well, I've been with the family we'll be married 14 years in October, and before that, so it's about 20 years, just about. So I remember hearing the story, and I didn't know a lot because at the time, Sarah wasn't talking a lot about it, as the kids said. And I think now she's talking about it because you talked about it earlier, that it was really a need for you to tell this story because you need the grandchildren to know the stories. And those stories need to keep being passed on. But I thought the story was horrific. I can't imagine being an 11-year-old, being in her shoes, what she went through. I mean, I can't even fathom, you know, that happening. Because when I look at my nieces and nephews and her children growing up, or when we were both 11 years old, all of us, I mean, could you imagine? Yeah. I mean, something like that? I mean, I can't even. And we still probably don't even know 90% of it. I think you've only told 10%. So.
I spent, almost 2 hours this morning talking, and it's not.
Not easy.
It's not pleasant.
No.
Not pleasant, and I didn't tell more than half.
But do you think it's because you want to bury it all, because you don't want to rehash it all?
It's hard.
It's hard.
I can't even imagine.
And I don't remember.
Right.
It's over 65 years.
Right.
Right.
More than that, 60, yeah.
And then Mickey went back, as you know, to her hometown this past year.
So what was that like, Mickey, when you went back? What was the experience like going to that town?
Well, we had you, and we had Ari, and we had Andy, and it was a bittersweet. The going back to Koretz, which was their town, but before that, we stopped at Wasser Alfingen, where I was born, and Ari was in camp with us, and he showed me where he stole the jeeps and all the cars and trucks. But it was
a little Trump in it.
Bittersweet,
I think you said.
Bittersweet, yeah. I think I had to go, and some of the things I didn't want to see. But yeah, all in all, I think it was good. It was positive. And I think we were very lucky that we found her house that she was born in, that she was raised, and then we found the house where she was hidden.
Right.
And I think, we found it the first time. Right? We stopped. Yeah. The first place we stopped, it was right there. And we were lucky. So it was good.
Sarah, if you were to give a message to future generations, to your family that's here and to the generations that follow, what would your message be for future generations?
I repeat it.
What would your message be for the future generations that follow?
Well, I would say to be good, to be honest, in everything else.
Yeah,
that's important. Okay. It's important. And I'm very lucky that I married a son, and I have 3 sons.
It's okay.
Okay.
It's okay.
Okay.
It's okay.
And what would you say to your mom, boys?
She did a hell of a job raising us. It was tough on her, especially with the language barriers and it was very hard.
Yeah.
A wonderful mother, a Yiddish mother. What else could you ask for? That the children come first.
Stevie brought up a good point. The language, when they had no language, they had no education, they had no family, they had no money, and my dad worked very hard. He worked 2 jobs. I never saw him. I'd wait up till 4 a.m, give him a bottle of beer, and he'd go to bed and get ready for the next job. So it was not easy. And we lived in a 3-flat, and it was the whole apartment was this size. So it was very, very humble beginnings. Very humble. I think that helped make good character for all of us.
Shapiro family, thank you so much.
Thank you.
This will be there as a lasting legacy. Your story has been told today, Sarah, and thank you for doing that.
It's okay, thank you. It should have been done a long time.
Early than never.
That's okay.
Never too late.
Right.
Never too late.
Right.
Thank you very much for taking your time.
Yeah, thank you. It was nice meeting you, and you did a wonderful job.
Thank you. You did a wonderful job, too.
Okay.
I told you he's not a bad guy. He kept telling me he didn't like him. I said he's okay.
Even I, right?
You too.
Good.
Okay.
Thank you.